Dictation 20. Ready? Obedience to the impulse is very unlikely to do much harm and may well do great good. The practical difficulty is to distinguish such impulses from desires which produce similar manifestations. Many young people wish to be authors without having an impulse to write any particular book, or wish to be painters without having an impulse to create any particular picture. But a little experience will usually show the difference between a genuine and a spurious impulse. For a time, then in thwarting the impulse which is genuine. Nevertheless, the plain man almost always has a tendency to thwart the genuine impulse because it seems anarchic and unreasonable, and is seldom able to give a good account of itself in advance. What is markedly true of some notable personalities is true, in a lesser degree, of almost every individual who has much vigor or force of life. There is an impulse towards activity of some kind, as a rule, not very definite in youth, but growing gradually, more sharply outlined under the influence of education and opportunity. The direct impulse toward a kind of activity for its own sake must be distinguished from the desire for the expected effects of the activity. A young may desire the rewards of great achievement without having any spontaneous impulse toward the activities which led to achievement. But those who actually achieve much, although they may desire the rewards, have also something in their nature which inclines them to choose a certain kind of work as the road which they must travel if their ambition is to be satisfied. The artist impulse, as it may be called, is a thing of infinite value to the individual and often to the world. To respect it in oneself and in others makes up 9/10 of the good life. In most human beings, it is rather frail, rather easily destroyed or disturbed. Parents and teachers are too often hostile to it, and our economic system crushes out its last remnants in young men and young women. The result is that human beings cease to be individual, or to retain the native pride that is their birthright. They become machine-made, tame, convenient for the bureaucrat and the drill sergeant, capable of being tabulated in statistics without anything being omitted. This is the fundamental evil resulting from lack of liberty, and it is an evil which is being continually intensified as population grows more dense and the machinery of organization grows more efficient. The things that men desire are many and various: admiration, affection, power, security, ease, outlets for energy are among the commonest of motives. But such abstractions do not touch what makes the difference between one man and another. Whenever I go to the zoological gardens, I am struck by the fact that all the movements of a stork have some common quality, differing from the movements of a parrot or an ostrich. It is impossible to put in words what the common quality is, and yet we feel that each thing an animal does is the sort of thing we might accept that animal to do. This indefinable quality constitutes the individuality of the animal and gives rise to the pleasure we feel in watching the animal's actions. In a human being, provided he has not been crushed by an economic or governmental machine, there is the same kind of individuality, a something distincting without which no man or woman can achieve much of importance or retain the full dignity which is native to human beings. It is this distinctive individuality that is loved by the artist, whether painter or writer. The artist himself and the man who is creative is, no matter what direction, has more of it than the average man. Any society which crushes this quality, whether intentionally or by accident, must soon become utterly lifeless and traditional. Without hope of progress and without any purpose in its being to preserve and strengthen the impulse that makes individuality should be the foremost object of all political institutions. We now arrive at certain general principles in regard to individual liberty and public control. The greater part of human impulses may be divided into two classes, those which are possessive and those which are constructive or creative. Social institutions are the garments or embodiments of impulses and may be classified roughly according to the impulses which they embody. Property is the direct expression of possessiveness. Science and art are among the most direct expressions of creativeness. Possessiveness is either defensive or aggressive. It seeks either to retain against a robber or to acquire from a present holder. In either case, an attitude of hostility toward others is of its essence. It would be a mistake to suppose that defensive possessiveness is always justifiable, while the aggressive kind is always blameworthy. Where there is a great injustice in the status, the exact opposite may be the case, and ordinarily neither is justifiable. State interference with the actions of individuals is necessitated by possessiveness. Some goods can be acquired or retained by force, while others cannot. A wife can be acquired by force, as the Romans acquired the Sabine women, but a wife's affection cannot be acquired in this way. There is no record that the Romans desired the affection of the Sabine women, and those in whom possessive impulses are strong tend to care chiefly for the goods that force can secure. Finished.